Hey guys, welcome back. So today I'm talking all about one-hit wonders, a.k.a. standalone romances. Now, if you have been around my channel for a while, you'll know that I absolutely adore series. In fact, I actually prefer series to standalones just because I like to sit with the characters longer. I like to see characters progress throughout multiple plot lines. But when it comes to romance, oftentimes series typically mean different things. So while you may have a certain character in a series kind of having its arc across multiple books, oftentimes series and romances just means like a shared universe or a shared world. So you might get, let's say, perfect example, Jill Shalvis. You know I absolutely love her books. In her Heartbreaker Bay series, each book focuses on a different couple. However, what brings it together as a series is the fact that it is a shared world, and that oftentimes the couples you might meet in the first book will show up in like the third book or the fourth book, etc. They're friends, they're cousins, brothers, etc. So again, I wanted to talk about some of my favorite standalone romances, because even though I love series, there have been quite a few exceptions to my I love series rules in terms of standalones that just stood out to me. So without further ado, let's go ahead and jump into the books that I absolutely adored. Okay, so starting off this list is Beach Read. Now, I read this book earlier this year and just fell hard for it. I'm pretty sure actually in the wrap-up that I did talking about this, I spent way too long gushing about it, and it's for a proper reason, because it was just so perfectly executed. If you're not familiar with the premise, just really quick, it is about a woman who goes to her recently deceased father's beach house. He left it for her after he passed away, and she was kind of like a struggling writer, struggling with writer's block, and so she thought that by going there she can kind of just zone out, work on her book, and also at the same time do a little bit of healing. Turns out her next door neighbor not only is also a fellow author, but it's actually somebody that she knew from back in college. The two of them agree to basically help each other out by trying on each other's genres, hoping that with get them out of some kind of creative rut. And so along the way, obviously, just so many emotions as they kind of grieve together, each of them for their own separate reasons, and at the same time fall for one another. Now, I absolutely adored this story. I thought that the writing was just brilliant. The dialogue actually was standout for me. It was one of my favorite parts in the story, or one of my favorite components, just because I thought it was so well done. It really not only moved the story forward, but was very realistic. I'm pretty sure when I talked about this the first time in my wrap-up, I was saying how the conversation between the heroine and one of her girlfriends was just so spot on. I could imagine myself having that same conversation with a friend. That still holds up. So if we had to kind of pick a book to kickstart this list with, Beach Read is definitely the one. It's a contemporary romance, and ironically, even though it's called Beach Read, it's pretty heavy for a beach read. I don't know if I would actually take it to read on the beach, just because I would look for something a little bit more light in tone, but at the same time, it's humorous, but I cried a lot. So just keep that in mind if you decide to check this one out. It's totally worth it though, and I absolutely love it. So this next one I want to talk about is called Hotshot Doc. It's actually by one of my favorite contemporary romance authors, R.S. Gray. I'm sure you guys have heard me talk about her before. She actually does a lot of series, but this is a standalone romance that's actually a medical romance. And if I'm not mistaken, this is actually my first medical romance that I ever read. And to be honest, I had no idea what to expect. I'm pretty sure I went into it thinking it was going to be a little bit like Grey's Anatomy. And thankfully, I was wrong. Not that there's anything wrong with that show or anything, but it's a little bit too heavy-handed on the drama for me personally, especially when it comes to my contemporary lighthearted romances. But anyway, I will say, just a quick side note, that there are Grey's Anatomy references in it, which I enjoyed as kind of like a cheeky nod to the reader. Like, yeah, I'm sure you thought it was going to be like Grey's Anatomy. But anyway, this one is a romance basically between, I think the woman is in residency at this particular hospital, and her boss, who she loves, this doc who has been kind of taking her under his wing, has decided to retire. And so he has chosen a replacement for himself, which is this naturally handsome, very cocky, hotshot doc, so to speak. And so the two of them have instant like hate to love chemistry. She thinks that he's such a pompous jerk, but she's obviously determined to stick it out because she, you know, she knows that this is a top hospital, and technically speaking, this guy is the best of the best. So needless to say, the two of them do end up kind of falling for each other, but I definitely enjoyed watching their journey as they did so. One of the things that I also enjoyed watching was kind of how they formed a relationship, because if I'm being honest, one of the reasons why I had steered clear before of medical romances is that I just couldn't find it realistic in my mind on how one would make that work, because I know that, you know, a hospital setting is very serious, you know. Any kind of like cutesy shenanigans or like coat closet kissing, I would find very unrealistic, and to be honest, a bit of a turnoff when it came to romance, because again, hospitals are serious places, you know. Doctors, I feel, have this level of trust, and as a patient, I don't want to have my doctor, you know, being distracted by thinking of, you know, his latest conquest that he just had a fumble with in the closet. But rest assured, this book handles their relationship so well. If anything, it really showed me how people in the medical field are able to compartmentalize when it comes to their professional life and their personal life. And that's exactly what our characters did. Not only just the hero as kind of like this actual medical doctor who's performing surgery, but also the residency heroine, who, you know, obviously is still, you know, in training and everything, but she takes her job very seriously. So I was actually really surprised to see how well it was done. And so I guess if you're new to medical romance or you haven't read one, just like I was new to it, definitely check this one out, because again, I think it was both a well done romance, but also was very respectful of the medical field. And if you have read a bunch of medical romances, first of all, give me some suggestions in the comments. But second of all, read this book and let me know what you think about it, because again, as this being my first foray into it, I thought it was really well done and another check on R.S. Grey's backlist that I absolutely adored. Next up, we have Stuck Up Suit by the iconic romance duo Vi Keeland and Penelope Ward. I've actually read a handful of their books and enjoyed them all thoroughly, but this one definitely takes the cake as my favorite. I will say going into it, I thought that I was going to be in for just a lighthearted contemporary romance, and don't get me wrong, it's definitely a contemporary romance that's done really well. However, Vi Keeland and Penelope Ward have a way of just really tugging at the heartstrings, and I did not at all see it coming in this book. It ended up being a lot more deeper than I anticipated, which I appreciated. Again, not that there's anything wrong with the fluffy romance, because that's actually my favorite, but I was just very well surprised with this one, and I really enjoyed that kind of switch up in terms of standalone romance. Now, in terms of the plot, let me just have a rundown really quick. It's essentially your opposites attract romance. We have this guy basically walking down the street in his pristine button-down suit, kind of yakking on the phone, being a douchebag. And our heroine is noticing him, of course, you know, wanting to steer clear because this guy seems like an impatient jerk with, you know, all the money in the world and none of the time to deal with anything. And I believe they meet on the train, or they're both on a train or something like that, but when he gets off, he accidentally drops his phone. And so because she is a good person, guiltily, she feels like she has to pick it up, if only so that she can return it to him, even though this guy is kind of a jerk. So she picks up his phone, she manages to find out where he works, and she goes to deliver his phone back to him. However, what's really funny about it is that when she does that, she ends up sending him like a little semi-inappropriate pic on his phone for him to see later, as kind of like a kind of like a middle finger to him being a jerk, but it only ends up backfiring because instead of making him angry, it actually turns him on. And so the two of them kind of start off their relationship with a texting back and forth, and they form a relationship. Now, I don't want to give spoilers away, so I'll kind of end the premise there, but some things definitely happen, again, that end up making this story a lot more deeper than I originally thought, tugging at the heartstrings. I'm pretty sure I also cried with this one. I feel like the standalone romances have a tendency to do that to me because I'm so invested. But anyway, like I said, it's a very well done story. This romance duo has hit it out of the park because they have a tendency to do that with their books. Especially, I want to say I might have listened to this on audiobook and it's excellently narrated. So definitely check this one out. Unfortunately, the Kindle Unlimited program, I'm sorry, the Audible Escape program has run up. So I don't know if this is on the Audible Unlimited, but regardless, definitely worth checking out and paying for it because the narration itself is so standout. And like I said, the premise is one that's very interesting, and I thought that it went deeper than originally expected in the best kind of way. Okay, so these next two are by the same author, but it would be remiss of me not to put them both on the list because they're both some of my favorite works of hers. And I'm talking about Whitney G., my like standout new to me author of 2020. I'm sure you guys have heard me gush about her multiple times, but there is a good reason why. Again, she also writes a lot of series. However, these two of hers that I have read are standalones and they're not part of any kind of shared universe, at least none that I know of. But the first one is called Can I Come Over? And the second one is called 30 Day Boyfriend. Both of these, I believe, are novella length and just, oh, chef's kiss. I love both of them. So the first one, just like a quick rundown. The first one, we basically have a romance author who is stuck in a creative writing block, coincidentally, because that's the same premise of Beach Read, but totally different stories. Anyway, she's stuck in like this writer's block, especially on this one sex scene, because like I said, she's a romance author. So she goes online and starts chatting with like one of her online friends that she had kind of made over the year. It happens to be a guy, and he offers to basically help her out with writing the sex scene. However, it goes beyond just, you know, him giving her words or critiques on her pages. It gets a little steamy, and needless to say, her writing block is definitely over with. However, as part of it, he actually offers to meet up with her because, again, they've been online friends this whole time, and they've never actually seen each other in person. But the trade-off is if he helps her with these pages, she will agree to meet with him in person. She does agree to meet with him in person, and that's all I'm going to tell you, because when they meet in person, holy smokes. I mean, the chemistry is outrageous, but there's also this twist of a surprise that, again, totally threw me off in the best kind of way. And oh my gosh, definitely one of my favorite standalone romances, because Whitney G has just such a way with like getting under your skin in the best kind of way. And I was just on the edge of my seat seeing how this couple not only met for the first time face to face, but how they plan to make their relationship work going forward. Again, well executed. And as far as 30 Day Boyfriend goes, we have a kind of like an office romance situation going on, where we have a woman who works for this guy who, the guy is like this stuck up power suit. Again, you're seeing a theme with the kind of books that I like. But anyway, she's ready to basically quit because this guy is like overworked her, run her to the ground, and she's ready to move on. However, the guy, even though he hasn't shown his appreciation for her, he really doesn't want to let her go and has told her that he will let her out of her work contract if she agrees to be his be his significant other, or pretend to be his significant other for 30 days. She has no choice basically but to go along with this because she really wants to get out of her contract. But needless to say, when the two of them kind of start doing their fake thing, real feelings, as they all do, end up being exposed. And it's just, Ah, it ends up being so sweet. It's one of my favorite novellas, not only by Whitney G., but just in general. I believe this is actually the first book of hers that I ever read, and so needless to say, I gave it 5 stars. Okay, so this next one, I gotta be totally honest, I don't know if it's actually an Audible exclusive, like audiobook only, or if they actually made a physical book version of it, but I know at the time when I read slash listened to it, it was only available via audio, and I'm talking about Heidi's Guide to Four Letter Words. Now, again, if you've been around my channel for a while, I'm sure you would have heard me talk about this book early this year or maybe end of last year, but anyway, let's just start off by saying I gave it 5 stars because it is just, to this day, I still think about this book because it was just so sweet, so charming, everything that I want and need in a romance book. but basically, it is a contemporary romance author, or excuse me, a contemporary romance that spotlights a heroine basically coming into her own and coming out of her shell. Because Heidi was a school teacher and she was recently let go of her from her job as a teacher. And so the next position that she finds that ends up hiring her is working as an office manager in this like an office where they record erotic novels, audio recordings. What am I trying to say here? Basically, she's working at a job where her job basically allows her to overhear people narrating erotic novels. And so because she's from this like Minnesota town and is such a good girl, this is not necessarily shocking to her, but definitely something that she was not at all expecting. However, because she was recently fired and is like looking for a new lease on life, she decides to stay with the job. And not only that, but decides to start a podcast actually where she's chronicling, you know, her days of just trying to become more of herself, basically. And that entails her getting the courage to ask her next door neighbor out. And it's so adorable. One of the reasons why, at least at the time, it was an audio exclusive is because not only do you get the main story of, you know, Heidi going about her day, but you also get to listen to her podcast episodes as she records them. And it's just so fun listening to her hijinks of her like hyping herself up to, you know, wear certain clothes, not necessarily in a way to change her character, but just to try something new on. And then also as she tries to get the nerve to ask out her neighbor, which she subsequently does, and then her chronicling their first date and all of that, so on and so forth. But man, do I love this story. Heidi is so charismatic. The narration is like perfect because you definitely get that Minnesota accent, which I think is key here because that really ingrains the reader in knowing, you know, how kind of small town Heidi is, at least as she starts off. But then again, she comes into being her own, and then by the end, she's just this fully realized woman that's proud of herself, not ashamed of anything, and oh, I just love it so much. Yeah, definitely as far as standalones go, check this one out. And even if it is available in print, I would highly recommend the audio version because, again, there's something so charming about her accent, and even the hero's narration is so well done that it's just, it's such a standout book for me in general. And the audio, like I said, it's one of my favorite audiobooks of all time. Okay, last on the list is coincidentally a romance set around Christmas, even though technically speaking, the whole book isn't taking place around Christmas, but it still gives you Christmas vibe and has scenes set in Christmas. Anyway, I don't even know why I kind of gave that introduction, probably because when I read it, it was last year around Christmas time. But I'm talking about a contemporary romance called One Day in December. This book had such Nora Ephron vibes, and I don't even know how to describe it beyond that. So hopefully you're familiar with Nora Ephron. She wrote and directed movies like Sleepless in Seattle, You've Got Mail, those really like feel good but euphoric but also bittersweet kind of romances, if that makes sense at all. But basically what happens is that the story starts off with this woman, side note, this takes place in London, by the way, not that that matters, but anyway. So one day the woman is on a bus and she sees this guy that she knows is like her soulmate. She thinks that he's handsome, and that, you know, he's got all the qualities that she feels like she wants in a guy. She envisions their future together. Again, very like almost like unrealistic movie expectations, but it's sweet. It's sweet. Trust me, guys. Anyway, so she goes back home and she ends up telling her best friend about this guy and proceeds to spend like the next year looking for him. And I mean, like, you know, obviously still taking that bus route and maybe like changing up the times and anything in that area to where she thinks slash hopes that she's able to stumble across this guy again. But alas, she never meets him. And so, like I said, it's been a year. And so she finally decides, you know, okay, maybe it's time to move on. Her best friend is like, look, girl, it was a cute idea like 9 months ago when you were still trying to look for him, but it's been over a year. You've never even talked to this mystery man. Let's just move on. You know, I've got some guy friends that I can hook you up with who are real people. Anyway, so she reluctantly is like, okay, fine. So, it's been a year. The next year that she is hanging out with her friend is like, okay, well, if you're over that guy, I will hook you up with somebody. But first, let me introduce you to my boyfriend. Yes, guys. Yes. Her best friend's boyfriend ends up being the guy she had been looking for the past year, her mystery dream guy. So naturally, she is both like shocked, gutted, and something happens to where she doesn't tell her friend. You know, I mean, at that point, it's like, why would you? It's not as if her friend would break up with the guy. But anyway, what proceeds to happen is her trying to free herself of these feelings or the notion of what could have been with this guy, which doesn't help because her friend basically keeps pushing the guy on her because she wants them to be friends. You know, you want your best friend and your boyfriend to get along with each other so you guys could all hang out as a group, blah, blah, blah. The only issue is that as she starts to actually learn about this guy, she falls for him. And it's just, it's such a good commentary into relationships because the whole like bros over hoes or chicks over dicks, you know, like she wants to be a good friend to her best friend, but it's really hard to ignore the feelings that she has about this guy. And so I just, it's just so sweet, so heart-wrenching in a lot of places. And I think the author did a really good job being sensitive to everyone in the story, because again, even though you're following the main character, sometimes I want her to actually get with the guy, but then other times I'm like, girl, you need to let him go because it's your best friend's boyfriend and you want them to be happy. So it's a bit of an emotional roller coaster, but in the best kind of way. And it's for that reason why it has a spot on this favorite or some favorites standalone list. Okay, so there you have it. That's actually quite a longer list than I anticipated. I've read, obviously, like dozens, hundreds of romances, but more often than not, they are part of a series just because that's what I tend to lean towards. I love me some series, but every once in a while, there will be a standalone romance that comes along and just like shakes me to my core. And you can see all of these books that I just listed, I have read like a while ago, at least a few months back, and I still remember them like I read them yesterday. That just goes to show like how much they have sat with me, how much they've left an impact, which is one of the reasons why I guess standalone romances or just standalone books in general are so good, because admittedly, as much as I love series, oftentimes, especially if you binge a series, everything will kind of like blur together. The plot lines will blur together from one book to the next. The couples, you won't necessarily remember each of their specific nuances just because you've been living in like this shared world for so long. Whereas with standalone romances, you know, the characters are very unique. Whatever they say and the things that they do and the nuances are very unique to that specific book and that specific place and time. And again, it just sits with you longer. So that said, I've kind of like convinced myself that I need to read more standalone romances. That might actually be a reading goal of mine for next year. But anyway, I hope you guys enjoyed this list. As usual, please let me know if you have read any of the books that I listed, and if so, what you think of them. And while you're at it, let me know if you do read romance, which of your favorite standalones you recommend, or I mean, I guess it doesn't have to be romance, but for the sake of this video, I'd love to know which romance is, especially if I'm going to have a goal next year to read more standalones. So that said, please like and subscribe if you enjoyed this video and you want to see more like it, and I'll talk to you guys in the next one. Happy reading. Bye.